Good evening, everybody. I'm going to talk to you about the notion of well-being and the potential that I think the notion of well-being has to help us craft new kinds of language education policy. Now, that assumes that we need new kinds of language education policy, and I certainly think that we do. But I'll get to that in a few minutes. What I want to do first is to talk about what I think is developing into a new momentum for organising public policy in basically in many, many countries. And I want to tell an anecdote about this from my own experience last year. I should explain that my first degree was in economics and political philosophy at Monash University, and I at the time remember thinking many, many times, like all economics students do, I know this is a very important subject. Most of the world runs on economics. I mean, as Angela said, I was president of the Australian Academy of the Humanities, and many people in the humanities in Australia grizzle about the fact that it seems that the society in general gravitates around science and technology and engineering subjects, and the humanities are neglected, and I think that that's often the case. However, there's one discipline within the humanities and social sciences that could never complain of marginalisation, and that's economics, which is actually the language of public life, really. If you imagine the way in which almost every field of education and other fields besides, the metaphors that we use to talk about what we do there are ones that are drawn from the marketplace. You know, we constantly organise things in terms of ideas of producer, consumer, seller, exchange, price. These are notions that come from classical economic principles. Last year, as in my role in the Academy of the Humanities, I was invited to attend a conference in Vienna. And when I'd done my economics degree, I had focused on a very famous interesting, bit weird, Viennese economist by the name of Josef Schumpeter, and turned up for this conference which was called Social Innovation. Now, if you think about how the language of innovation operates in public policy, not many people modify it with the adjective social. People usually think innovation is really about technology or something like that. So it was interesting to see what was going on at this conference on social innovation. And we turn up and there's this great big video screen, and this Austrian professor who died 40 years ago or something rather, with his little bow tie and his Harvard accent, because he decamped to Harvard at a certain time, welcoming everyone in a kind of perfect Austrian English to the conference in his hometown. And what happened over the course of the 2 days was that he basically stalked us, because the people who made the video kept on updating it during the course of the conference, and he kept on coming on and commending us for what we'd done, or chastising us for not having done enough talk about his 1924 book or whatever it happened to be. But what was really interesting about it was not just that kind of innovation where you have an eminence grise from the past comes to stalk you, but the fact that economists, huge numbers of them, were trying to grapple with the idea without almost admitting it, that economic-based public policy around the world, and mainly in the European Union, because that's where it's based, but it was an international conference, really didn't have as much traction on the world as they had believed it would have. There were so many problems, the problems of the financial crisis most obviously, but many others, which really they had predicted would have been solved or should have been solved. Many more people acting irrationally according to economic nostrums. Many more problems in the world arising which weren't imagined to be there. And what they were effectively saying was that it was important for humanities scholars with the kind of appreciation that I think the humanities tends to have for subjectivity and experience and narrative and how people live and experience the world, to interact with and dialogue with people from the sciences and the economics. Economics imagines itself to be a science, the science of economics. But if political science can call itself a science, it's very clear that the word science has multiple kinds of meanings. So basically we had an admission from people in directing public policy, the most powerful people in the intellectual world, really, that the understanding of the social world was not one that could be contained just within one discipline. I think no one here would dispute that. I think that many people in those fields find it very difficult to admit this. So it was a great eye-opener to me. They were talking about questions of ageing and why, for example, people had invented incredibly sophisticated technologies but were not being used by people for whom they had been intended. Or why much simpler technologies had taken off in some places and complex ones hadn't. But, you know, I think we could all imagine why that would be the case. They were wondering about why in urban settings with residential policies to distribute people, people still preferred to live in particular places with particular people. Why housing policies that they had imagined would produce more free-flowing traffic hadn't done this. There were lots and lots of things. So they were almost admitting to extensive failure to predict the way the world works. Of course, ultimately, because if you believe that things are knowable in particular kinds of ways, you miss out a lot on the way humans are constructed. So in the course of this, someone said at one point, but this social innovation, what has it got to do with well-being? And then it started to ring to me that basically public policy needs terms around which texts are organised. And well-being is the one of the future. I don't think social innovation is going to really take off. And you can see this already. In Australia, the Prime Minister's Science, Engineering and Innovation Council, there is no Prime Minister's Humanities and Social Sciences Council. There's a Prime Minister's Science, Engineering and Innovation Council. There's no Chief Humanist advising the Australian government, but there is a Chief Scientist. So the imagined development of the nation, as we all know, this won't come as a surprise to anyone, is seen to be generated by the technologies, engineering, science. So clearly the modes of reasoning, the way they think about the world, are the ones that prevail. So we see those things reflected in the way public policies are crafted and the ideologies they reflect. The Prime Minister's Science, Engineering and Innovation Council has just commenced 6 major projects, and in the titles of 4 of them is the word well-being. I'm on one of these, which is called Australia's Comparative Advantage. And in tracking what Australia's comparative advantage might be into the long-term future, we have fields of focus that include diversity, tolerance, public harmony, democracy, a democratic ethos, etc. So a whole range of things which I think classically would not have been included in consideration of how a nation might imagine its development. So you can see that there's a struggle now in public policies in many parts of the world. In my talk earlier this morning, I put up a slide from the UK. The House of Lords and the House of Commons, the houses of the UK Parliament, the unelected one and the elected one, have issued a really major report on well-being and the whole idea of a national framework for well-being in the United Kingdom to try and correct over-reliance on straightforward economic measures like GDP. And among the Prime Minister's Science and Innovation Council developments are 3 others like this. One of them is called ANDI, A-N-D-I, the Australian National Development Indicators, which is a way to develop something like the happiness index, but in a way that will work. So far, newspapers refuse to report these in new indices to describe social wellness and well-being and community harmony and other kinds of things. But nevertheless, there's a lot of work going on in this regard. The OECD, which is, you know, the Paris-based Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, one of their chief economists, who's now the director of the Statistics Institute in Rome, Enrico Giovanotti, developed this long scale and the most sophisticated version of modes of describing social progress that don't rely just on employment statistics. I'm not saying those things aren't important. Of course, they're very important. If you're unemployed, they're very important. But they don't rely just on those kinds of things, partly because the societies that do well, that do best in those statistical things, do very poorly, interestingly enough, on other measures of, we'll call them the happiness category of indicators. So from the OECD, from the Prime Minister's Science and Engineering and Information Council and Innovation Council, from the UK Houses of Parliament, and I don't know much about this in relation to the United States, but I imagine similar kinds of things are going on. There is an upwelling of well-being considerations. In other words, there's trying to be included into public policy documents ways to talk about social progress that include measures, and they want to measure things, indicators rather than measures of progress that aren't strictly based around traditional ones that economists have produced. And this has generated a whole language of well-being. And in the UK, they talk about the distinctions between the following five categories. They talk about individual well-being, which is kind of understood to be narratologically produced, how people talk about well-being themselves. In other words, their subjective account of how their lives are going, everything in their lives, you know, their relationships, their children, their education, their aspirations, their feelings of physical health and mental and other kinds of, all these kinds of things. So a really rich set of personal accounts of well-being. And this is now increasingly being regarded as not some randomly idle thing that people just get out of novels or you buy books in airports about how people are feeling, but that it's taken seriously as accounts that people should, in public policy, be interested in. The next one is social group well-being, and this is a really interesting development because Britain and America and Australia all come from a particular tradition of regarding rights and opportunities and public policy as inhering in individuals, not in groups. Our societies don't recognise group rights. We don't really recognise individual rights in many areas either, but we don't recognise group rights at all. And language is clearly a group right, if it's anything at all. So it struggles to make a presence in public policy. That's why we have no strict language rights in Australia at all. So social group well-being in the United Kingdom starts to look at how groups who define themselves by particular modes that are important to them, those groups, how they account for their sense of well-being, whether they are included in the society, if they're a minority population. Do they feel safe on the streets if they're women that are in certain places at a particular time of the day? These kinds of accounts, and these are important, but they have always been unincluded or not even recognised. They were just seen to be the personal sort, but these ones are group ones, okay? Then there's national well-being. That's uses a lot of economic data in the way I was saying before, but not just that. Then other accounts of subjective and objective well-being. So there's been developed now a language of accounting for well-being, which is starting to be more sophisticated and elaborated. So will these efforts to develop indicators and to develop ways of speaking, categories to distinguish different kinds of well-being and ways of speaking about them, will they have an impact on public policy? That's really the question. And very importantly, will they have an impact on language policy? I think they should most definitely be embraced by everyone in this room. Wherever you see a public official, use the word well-being, because well-being as an indicator takes us to a different kind of language policy from how policy is premised today. 2 years ago, I did a study of the three language policies Australia had at the time. We had NALSP, the National Asian Languages and Studies of Asia in Schools, but whatever the acronym stood for. That had $67 million a day. Then there was one that Minister Macklin and Garrett had issued on Indigenous languages, and that had $4 million. And then you had one on all other languages, which had no money in it whatsoever. So that's an indicator of which kinds of policies have traction. And if you looked at the discourse in those policies, you would see that one of them, two of them, the one to do with Indigenous languages and other languages, had a lot of well-being type talk within them, but that had no policy traction. The one that had all the talk about trade and GDP indicators had all the money. So you can see, we can predictably see which discourses have more traction in public policy. So now, as we develop new policies, and we just had the Prime Minister issue one very recently, it's entirely about the traditional measures of trade and so on, and we can see the ways in which we have to utilise the promise or the potential promise of well-being. I wouldn't say that it's going to be around forever or for even a long time. If you look at public policy over a period of time, what you see is that there are fashions and things, but what is there is a constant struggle to bring into public policy languages, and I mean here discourses, other than strictly economic ones. And I think wellbeing is the current one we're going through. I want to just finish now by saying something about the connection between wellbeing and language as it could be. And I want to refer us to a statement very succinctly made by Michael Halliday, Professor of Linguistics at Sydney University many years ago, when he said that the relationship between language and learning was along these kinds of lines. He said, we learn through language, and we learn about language. I think we could pluralise all of those, and we'd get a very useful device for thinking about how well-being should be applied in public policy. We should think of well-being, and we should criticise public policies from state and federal government and universities that don't deal with notions of well-being in relation to learning language, that is, learning the languages of our community, the languages of Indigenous and immigrant populations in Australia, as well as foreign trade languages. Learning through languages, in other words, much more systematic and careful bilingual immersion, CLIL type programs that we know reach deeper levels of proficiency, produce deeper levels of proficiency than traditional ones. And learning about language, I think all students should know much more about language and communication than they do. And I'm going to finish with another anecdote on this particular point. I'll have to try and anonymize it, but some years ago, I was working with a school, a bilingual school. You'll probably all know it when I mention it, that teaches a major international language of Europe, which used to once be the major international language of diplomacy. It's a binational school. And this particular school, it's French school, right? They had a very impressive program. And I was talking to some of the students about the ideas of difference and otherness and so on that you learn out of this. And it was very clear, and this has been a traditional problem in foreign language teaching, that a large part of what foreign language programs do is teach admiration. They teach us to like the target language group that we are studying. So you can imagine that these students admired the culture of the language they were studying. What they couldn't do, and what I thought was very sad, and what I think this third principle, learning about language, should be made to do, is that we should learn something that goes beyond just the target group we are studying. If we learn about language, we should learn to admire speakers of multiple languages, and indeed of the principles of difference that lie behind language. Because it's not likely that most students in Australia will study Australian languages, so we've got to be able to include broader, generalisable principles within. So I think those three, learning language, learning through language, learning about language, pluralising both of them, so that we're talking about languages in all cases. I think if we put those things together and we start talking to public policy officials, saying you're now interested in, like these economists in Vienna, you're now interested in the traditional lack of success of public policy, and that's why you're taking an interest in well-being, because it seems that well-being brings in community perspectives and subjectivity which has been neglected in the past. Language is a key value, a core value, an important characteristic of our society and of many component peoples within it. And we want to advocate a different kind of language policy. So well-being allows us to enter public conversations around public policy in a way that I hope will give us more traction. Thank you.